I got a Desi feeling.
What is going on, everybody? I'm Jabby Kuwait, joined by Haley Seats. And we're looking at India's World War III plan, according to the Infographics show. This dropped 6 months ago. I have no idea the validity or the accuracy of the video that we are about to watch herein. I have no idea. I'm just like here for the interesting possible tidbits offered by Infographics show. It's a channel that I've watched quite a number of times just for like random fun facts.
Okay.
Or fun facts I should check. Citation needed. You know what I'm saying? You guys, if you haven't done so already, hit that subscribe button, bell icon, all notifications, pretty please. Vote this up. Let YouTube know you're enjoying what you're watching, why you're subscribing and upvoting. Subscribe to the Infographics show. There's a link in the description below. If you want to click on that, give the original an upvote. Subscribe to them from there. I'm going to read this little blurb right here right quick. India has the bad luck of having two antagonistic neighbors sitting right on its borders. It also has the good luck of having the superior strategic position. Check out today's epic new video to find out how India is preparing for World War III.
India has the bad luck of having two antagonistic neighbors sitting right on its borders. It also has the good luck of having the superior strategic position. This is how India will fight World War III.
Hey, that sounds familiar. I feel like I heard it somewhere. Why does it sound so familiar?
India's geography makes it, like the United States, in effect a fortress nation. Unlike the United States, though, who is protected by two vast oceans and a polar ice cap, India's fortress has one gap in its armor. To the north, India faces China, a nation that initially got along with it very well. Both India and China spurred the non-aligned movement, which sought to see their nations avoid being forced into either the American or Soviet camp during the Cold War. However, tensions over an unsettled border dispute in the north and China's drifting toward the Soviet Union soon frayed the relationship. When China invaded Tibet and
Wait, it said something about Russia just now.
Yeah.
China's drifting towards the Soviet Union. This video is not stating whether they mean that in a positive or a negative way, but also that's 1950, so my information might be outdated, but India has a history with Russia that is positive. So that's a little bit of a confusing statement for me, but maybe the video will elucidate.
Frayed the relationship. When China invaded Tibet and annexed it in 1950, relations hit an all-time low.
Yeah, Tibet is what kind of screwed things up.
Three major conflicts with a full-blown war in 1962, which
So India was sympathetic towards Tibet, is my understanding,
yeah,
and that's why China had an issue.
China technically won. Two standoffs between Indian and Chinese troops occurred in 1967 and 1987, threatening to bring the two nations to war once more. However, in the new millennium, the relationship improved dramatically. Until the 2010s, when a series of border disputes once more threatened the tenuous peace. These disputes have grown in intensity, with the most serious occurring in 2020, which left 20 Indian soldiers dead and an unknown number of Chinese dead. A U.S. congressional investigation found that China had planned in advance for the clash, including for the possibility of fatalities. The fact that China once more achieved its goals and pushed Indian control even further back in the region is proof that this was no accident. To the west, India faces its longtime rival, Pakistan. The two nations have fought multiple wars over the last 70 years, with India typically coming out victorious over its smaller neighbor. However, Pakistan soon turned to directly funding and equipping terrorists to attack India asymmetrically, with many terror attacks in India directly linked to Pakistan's intelligence services. The two nuclear-armed nations remain at tenuous peace today, but Pakistan's realigning toward China has ended India's policy of non-alignment. Realizing it needs friends in this new and much more dangerous world, India has made some very historic moves in drawing closer ties to the United States. Russia has traditionally been India's closest partner from the two powers, but significant failures on Russia's part in developing joint weapon systems such as the Su-57, as well as its significantly reduced position on the world stage, and Russia's own growing ties to China, is working to fracture that relationship.
Oh.
Now, India's interested in...
Okay. That's new information. I would love to hear from you guys in the comments about that. I didn't know that that was actually creating any kind of tension at all between Russia and India. Fun fact, when Trump went to India to speak, Modi introduced him as Doland Trump, which translates to two dicks.
Really?
So.
Really?
Yeah.
Oh.
That became a big running joke. But I don't think Modi
Really?
Intended it to come out that way. Okay. He was trying to say Donald Trump, and it said
Donald. It just was the accent. Yeah. Okay.
In potentially acquiring more American weapons and realigning itself closer to the U.S. and its Western allies. India's northern border is thoroughly protected by the Himalayan mountains, which form a nearly impenetrable border against any possible Chinese incursion. China, realizing very early on that it sat on the low end of the strategic high ground, invaded Tibet to both prevent it being used as a staging ground for a potential Indian invasion against it and to secure the headwaters of multiple rivers that are vitally important for the Chinese nation. Since then, China has worked to push Indian control further and further back on its side of the Himalayas, all in a bid to prevent India from having the opportunity to seize plateaus and establish logistical bases from where it could fly in heavy equipment. While China has built its own, India has not, which means India is wholly incapable of using heavy equipment in any conflict against China. India's robust air defense capability also means that while China may have secured the high ground, a southern invasion of India is suicidally impossible. India has little to fear from a ground war with China, though China's forward position in the heights does mean it'll certainly lose what little control it has left over the Himalayan region. India's biggest concern is its western border with Pakistan. Pakistan has typically suffered great losses in its clashes with India over the years, and today India is an exponentially more capable military power than Pakistan. A modern conflict between the two nations would inevitably be to India's favor, and with such overwhelming military power, it could threaten the Pakistani national government itself. This is why Pakistan has flat out stated it would be willing to use nuclear weapons to defend itself in a future war, putting India in a very difficult position. To counter this threat, or at least limit its effectiveness, India has developed a deep strike doctrine, wherein Indian forces concentrate power in a small area of the front to achieve a deep, penetrating offensive into Pakistan itself. This would place Indian forces inside Pakistani territory and force it to use nuclear weapons on its own soil if it wishes to use them at all. A bigger threat to India would be a conventional war between itself, China, and inevitably Pakistan, with the basing of Chinese troops in Pakistan itself. With no fear of invasion of its own territory, China is free to use its ground forces well outside of China. And with the Chinese military on the whole superior to India's...
This is going so quick.
It is. It is.
So, okay. So 1.4 million.
Is this India on the side?
Yeah.
Okay.
2.2 million. Okay. 2,000, 3,000.
Ooh, but they have a lot of combat aircraft compared.
They have a lot of...
boats.
Sea vessels.
Yeah.
Warships. They have a lot more warships. They have three times.
That's a lot.
Yeah.
Ooh. Okay.
Twice as many nuclear warheads. But I mean, you use a few of those, it's like the world's over.
The whole thing with that.
If the two powers join together for a major offensive, this is unlikely, though not impossible, and would inevitably draw in other powers such as the U.S. on India's side. India's biggest problem is its lack of a native arms industry, as well as the hodgepodge nature of its current military hardware. As an unaligned state, India has been very opportunistic and chosen to arm itself with what it considered the weapons that suited its needs best from both the West and the former Soviet Union, now Russia. However, this has left it in the unique position of not having particularly deep defensive ties to either of them. And it's the reason why India today is not a partner with any nation that fields modern fifth-generation fighters. If you're likely to deal with someone's potential rival...
Look at the ass on the British chick. What the hell's that about? It's so random.
Nobody's going to invite you to share their best hardware, except Russia, which was cash-strapped and turned to India to finance its Su-57. Unfortunately for both sides, India pulled out of joint development when it was clear the Su-57 would never meet its projected goals and would be far outclassed by American and even Chinese fifth-generation fighters. Without a native arms industry, India is naturally reliant on foreign suppliers, which is tricky when those suppliers end up at each other's throats. Today, India is taking steps to attempt to kickstart a native defense industry, but it's waking up to the reality that unless it picks a side, and fast, it's going to be left behind technologically. This is why India has been slowly shaking off its non-aligned status and moving closer to the United States, much to the chagrin of China. Famously, India's attempt to build a domestic tank, the Arjun, was not only decades behind schedule, but ended up forcing the Indian government to buy a small fleet of tanks in 2013. By 2015, almost the entire fleet was inoperable. India does not lack the intellectual capital or manufacturing capabilities, but it does lack the expertise and the highly specialized and often classified knowledge of renowned global arms manufacturers such as Russia, France, Germany, and the United States. Modern weapons are built on a foundation of decades of research and development, trial and experimentation, and direct battlefield observations, all of which India lacks and can't simply be kickstarted overnight. However, India has one significant strategic advantage over both Pakistan and China, specifically over China, and that's its navy. The Indian Navy operates a fleet of mostly modern ships, and it's the second most powerful in Asia. However, the Indian Navy has one significant advantage over China. It is fully capable of over-the-horizon blue water operations, meaning it can operate far from its own shores. This is a capability that China struggles with due to its limited fleet logistics and a lack of aircraft carriers. Today, India fields 2 aircraft carriers, 11 destroyers, 13 frigates, 1 ballistic missile submarine for nuclear deterrence, and 16 conventional attack submarines. Okay. This allows India to project significant power where it matters most, in the Indian Ocean.
A lot of the trade that China does happens around India.
Okay.
And so if there was ever any kind of, you know how like Trump put embargoes?
Yeah.
I forgot what the restrictions
are
called.
Yeah, they shut down the shipping. Yeah.
India has its own way of doing that, which is to just interrupt China's ability to do any kind of sea trade of any kind. Like India can really mess China up if they wanted to. That's the thing. It's like, okay, you might have like a significantly more firepower, but like there's so much that depends on the sea still that it's kind of insane. Like our internet is through sea cables. We think of
everything. I've never even thought about that.
Yeah, we think of everything happening in the sky. Like when we're trying to like get a phone call, it's like, is it the satellite? But like all of our internet runs under the ocean.
I totally forgot about that.
You know, everything we buy on Amazon comes over shipping containers. And so it's like you mess up the sea, you mess up everything, potentially.
Mm-hmm. Navy allows India to effectively shut down Pakistan's coastal trade, but it's even more important for one key reason. It allows India to hold a dagger to China's throat. With its navy able to project power deep into the Indian Ocean, India is able to almost completely shut down China's seaborne trade, of which it's heavily reliant on for its oil and gas consumption, as well as its economy.
You take out its oil, they're done. How are you going to fly your planes, you know?
With 2 aircraft carriers and multiple choke points in the Malacca Straits and off of Indonesia's waters, the Indian Navy can bring China's imports to an almost complete standstill. China recognizes this, which is why it's been quickly working to develop its own aircraft carriers. Inevitably, the balance of power will shift toward China, with its ability to field a much larger force and more modern weapons, but this is still decades away. Even then, India enjoys one advantage China does not, and that is its growing relationship with the United States. Many Indians favor continued non-alignment, preferring to keep India out of the world's conflicts. However, this is no longer a possibility, given China's rapid ascension and expansionist ambitions.
Yeah, you gotta pick a
side,
I guess.
As the world's largest democracy, India poses an existential threat to China's Communist Party, who's working to export its model of authoritarianism abroad in a bid for self-survival. China has already helped many regional despotic powers with tracking and surveillance technology, for instance, in a bid to keep tabs on their citizenry. China is also aiming to establish a global monopoly on technology itself. Every year, China poses a greater and greater threat to Taiwan, and while many Indians might consider this a domestic dispute, the truth is far from it. Taiwan is not just a friendly democracy sitting off the CCP's shores, but also the supplier of almost the world's entire demand for microelectronics.
We are depending on that.
Yeah.
The semiconductor from Taiwan, because of the semiconductor shortage. I believe, if I'm not mistaken, Apple turned to the Taiwan manufacturer to get the chips that it needs. And even now, we're still in that situation, even with that help of like not having enough semiconductors or something like that, or hitting certain Moore's Law, whatever the... You know what I'm talking about. If you're an engineer, you know what I'm talking about. I don't know what I'm talking about. I hear these things on, you know, the tech channels and stuff like that. I'm like, okay. So, iPhone 15.
No, but I did hear like there was like... a big shortage, especially like it was a few years ago, I think, during
because
COVID.
Of pandemic.
It was like really bad. Like they were out of everything.
It's also because of crypto and stuff like that. But yes, the chip shortage affects everything, including cars.
And yes. So, oh my gosh. Yes. Yeah. I was trying to get a new car. And
it's double the price.
Double the price. And I still can't get it.
Yeah.
Like it's not available anywhere.
Yeah. Yeah. And so that's Taiwan's extremely important for that reason.
Semiconductor manufacturing company, or TSMC, supplies the world with nearly its entire supply of modern microchips, absolutely integral for any economy. Its 5-millimeter manufacturing process produces the smallest, most advanced microchips in the world, without which modern weapons as well as modern consumer electronics are impossible. If China were to take Taiwan, it would do so along with its manufacturing and intellectual capabilities, leaving China with global hegemony over the microchip supply and holding it hostage to the CCP and its goals. Anyone who disagrees with the CCP might simply face an export ban, crippling their economy. This will give China incredible leverage over India that would take decades to overcome. While TSMC is building a modern manufacturing facility in America to help offset this massive strategic vulnerability, it's refusing to allow for construction of its new 3-nanometer microchips anywhere outside of Taiwan. This is an insurance policy to help ensure that the global community remains vested in Taiwan's independence, but once more poses a significant vulnerability should China take Taiwan by force. If India is going to continue to thrive in the 21st century, its days of non-alignment have to end. Otherwise, it could simply find itself waging a losing Third World War against a technologically superior opponent, or simply forced into submission by its regional rival, China.
What do you think?
Well,
what are your feelings?
Okay, so I'm glad that it's not what I thought when we first saw the title. I was like, oh no.
Oh, you thought it was like an offensive strategy?
Well, no, I thought it was like on the brink of war. But
oh, we
not,
always are.
but not like to the extreme I was thinking. I was like, oh my gosh, am I missing something? Is there like about to throw down right now? I'm glad that's not the case. But no, it's really interesting because I never really looked at like the terrain over there. Obviously you have the ocean, but I never thought about the Himalayan mountains and how that prevents China from coming over. And then Pakistan, they were saying that you just have to, in military strategy, just go into their country so they have to bomb themselves rather than, which is, I never thought about that either. That's a smart strategy to do.
Yeah.
But hopefully none of that happens. Hopefully everyone remains friends.
Yeah, it's almost like a Cold War, you know. Everyone is just kind of on edge and trying to create strategies to make sure that they can protect themselves from each other. What's fascinating about this is that there, you know, China was supposedly making moves to protect itself from an invasion from India, and it's like India has just been dealing with their own invasions for centuries, and then it's like, can you just leave us alone?
They also just explained the mountains too, so that's gonna be so hard for like India to strike back via land because of the mountains. And then I don't feel like India is going to take the time to go around all the way to China via the sea. So like, why go after them?
So India has been doing its own moves, as I understand, in order to account for what China's doing. I forgot what they called it, like the diamond or something like that, because like China's got the pearls.
Okay.
And these are code words for like what China's doing. Basically, China's putting its hand in all these different pots in order to ensure that should they need to, you know, do some kind of aggressive strategy, they can execute it without fail and they won't be stopped. And so India's kind of doing its own thing, the diamond or whatever, making friendships with all these different countries to avoid China being able to overtake it.
Yeah, and you have allies similar how with like Ukraine right now, the U.S. helping Ukraine.
Exactly.
So the same way.
Yeah.
What I was going to say is, but regardless of like all the strategies, it always worries me with just the nuclear aspect of it, because if they launch what, like, didn't they say like 7 or something, then like we're over or something. Like, it's like not very many nuclear bombs have to go off for like everything to end. So it kind of scares me always when you think of that.
That's why to me it's just a constant never-ending cold war with everyone having
the button to press.
You know, a gun that would kill everybody at once. You know, it's kind of crazy how close we came to World War III a couple of times. There's this video, it might have been by Infographics that I had seen, or someone else, I don't know. But anyway, there was like a Russian submarine off of the southeastern coast of America.
Yes, I remember that.
And, you know, there was this instruction that supposedly came in for the submarine to launch nukes on America. And it wasn't actually the message that came in.
Okay.
And so the captain of the ship had to like make a decision. It was up to him whether or not to push this button off of instructions he didn't actually receive.
Ooh.
And he was like, you know what? I'm not going to push this button. I'm not going to start this war right now. And thankfully he didn't do that, because then a lot of people would have died off of him pushing that button. Isn't that crazy?
Yeah.
And so, you know, we're constantly in that sort of weird state where at any moment this could all happen, right?
Yep.
I don't know much about the validity of what was expressed in the video, but if it is true that India needs to pick a side, which I can understand India like trying to stay neutral, even as armed as they are and as strategic as they've been, they're in a vulnerable spot. You know, they have two enemies right there at their borders that they're constantly dealing with. And so I get why they're trying to be careful and not piss off anybody, but it does make sense to like have an ally pick a side, like a very clearly definitive side of like, this is the righteous path right here, and this is what we're gonna do, because that right there doesn't make sense for humanity. But again, I don't know what I'm talking about. I'm making an opinion off of what was expressed here. I don't know exactly what the video is expressing with regards to India's relationship to Taiwan, but I think part of the point was to explain that you can't be neutral on Taiwan.
Okay.
Taiwan is, it's like, it's not just a humanitarian thing of like, Taiwan wants to be independent. It's a matter of like business on the global scale that China will have virtually 100% control over. Like literally 100% control. It's like that it was illustrating how important the manufacturing of those chips in Taiwan is.
Yeah.
And we don't have that here in the States.
Yeah, they said they're trying to set up one place and it's not going well. So
yeah, I thought that was informative. I mean, assuming that it's accurate and whatnot, I thought that was a nice informative video. Kind of a Cliff Notes version of like all this stuff that's going on in the global theater. I thought that some of the visuals are going by super quick.
Yeah,
though,
and there
I
was like, it was moving very quickly, but yeah. I feel like we got a majority of it.
Yeah, so. Yeah, hopefully
the big stuff.
Yeah, hopefully. I appreciated the details, and then like they have the specific numbers of like the so the amount of warships that they have, the aircraft carriers, and the actual military planes and all that stuff. And they explained, you know, India. India's strongest muscle is its ability to do damage through the sea.
Trade route.
And so China's been trying to figure out workarounds to that. They're trying to figure out workarounds to everything.
Of course.
You know, I mentioned this a couple times, but like you can look up videos on Mongolia, and Mongolia is kind of like caught in the middle of everything between Russia and China right now, because Russia and China are trying to make themselves invincible to America's tariffs or whatever it's called, or America's, I can't find the freaking word, but the embargo or whatever, where America stops China from doing certain things.
I think that is what it's called.
Where they're able to punish China and say you can't do trade or blah, blah, blah. Mm-hmm. And so China and Russia are like allies, which is a threat to America's ability to be you know, the big cowboy in the room and be like, you can wag its finger. It's like, dude, you can't. And like, so it's all about the allies right now. Right? And who's allied with who? And so Russia and China being allied, that's a strong...
Yeah, those are the other two pretty much biggest.
Yes,
yeah,
exactly.
So
that's frightening.
Yeah.
You know? It's quite frightening. And so, obviously, this is biased, but I hope India and America continue to strengthen their ties with each other. Mm-hmm. And the only way we can do that is by electing an Indian president from the Republican Party.
I'll just throw that one in there.
You guys, thanks so much for hanging out. Hopefully you enjoyed that. I'm Jabby Kuwait. This is
Haley Seat.
Peace out.